Hi, I hope everybody had a good lunch and wants to attend that. So actually, you might have listened to my previous talks. This one is not so technical. Of course, it's still technical, but this is more something like about the early days after I got committed to Lucene, and then I had a talk at the Berlin Buzzwords every year, and this is just something like the most interesting or funny moments of code hacking from my perspective, because of course there are other committers which have the focus on other stuff, but this one is mostly about that stuff where I was also personally involved, and some other committers which I was mostly working together with. So the first thing is here about my background. I think he already talked about it. So I'm a PMC member of Apache Lucene and Solr, and I implemented originally the fast numerical search. I will come back to that in a short moment. I'm also working, I also like Elasticsearch very well, so mostly when I'm implementing something new with Lucene based on full-text search, I'm using Elasticsearch, and I'm working at Marum University of Bremen, and we also have a consulting company. That's called SD Data Solutions. So, okay, so here's the overview. I split it up into several eras. You might notice, so the first one is the heavy committing era, which started at the beginning. Then we had something in Lucene which is called the finite state era. Then we had something like an hotspot era, which is about Java and some bugs inside. Then we had a policeman era. And the final one is a Raya era, which is just for completeness here, but this will go to the latest developments in Lucene, which I would not closely talk about, but because the term era is something, so the last one is about the Japanese calendar, which had a change this year, so they're starting a new era, and because of that, of course, Lucene needs support for that, so it's included here. Okay, so the first one is about the heavy committing. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to find the original sound we had in the 2011 Berlin Buzzwords conference when Simon Willnow and I had a talk where there was a Barbara Streisand heavy committing song. Unfortunately, the webpage is still there, and you can press on the button, but it does not generate the sound, and I didn't have a some MP3 of it. So unfortunately, I cannot present that to you. So it was because it's the heavy committing is I think 3-4 syllables, and that's perfectly for that song. Yeah. So about what is this heavy committing all about? So this is also from the same year. It was a Simon Willnow says. So once at that time, there was a huge flow of commit emails, and he said it was something like 50 emails, and he was asking on the mailing list, hey, Uwe, what are you doing there? And I was just answering, I'm just heavy committing. And that's what this heavy committing is coming from, and this is now going on whenever something new or big in Lucene and Elasticsearch and Solr is done, there's always something, somebody always mentions the term heavy committing is going on, especially if there are a lot of emails coming in on separate branches, like when Solr got HTTP2 access recently, there was a lot of heavy committing coming in. So that's the background of that one. But the reason for that, why were there so many emails at that time? The reason for that was in 10 years ago, when the first Berlin Buzzwords was starting, we were on the change between Lucene 2.4 and 2.9 and 3.0. And at that time, everything, like at that day, was all the Apache projects were really, really strict on backwards compatibility and also Java versions. So the minimum Java version required was 1.4 at that time. And we had to change that. And there was really at that time, it was always like that. Whenever a new release came out, we archived all the tests of the old Lucene version, and we executed it against the new char file of the later version of Lucene to just figure out if the method signatures and everything is still there. So you were able to just replace the char file, and it was working. That was something which unfortunately has some problems because it gives you a flood of commits. And then a little bit later, with Lucene 3.0, we also decided to add Java 5 support. So that was in 2010, I think. At that time, it was already Java 6 was used everywhere, but the minimum requirement was Java 5 at that time. So, and the flood of commit emails were coming from mostly from the fact that somebody was suddenly adding generics to all the list, array lists, and whatever there. And this led to the fact that we had those huge flood of commit emails. And there was also something that the development 2.9 at that time was a version which was binary compatible to the 3.0 version. It was just running with Java 4, and it has had all the deprecated methods, and with the release of 3.0, everything was released. So here's something like, I think you cannot read it, but it's about that. So mostly it was any adding of generics to the Lucene code, and something like you don't mind replacing string buffer by string builder. That was a long time ago. So that's something that came here. And another thing which was also really interesting because of the backwards compatibility and heavy committing was the first try to get rid of the token class. So if you remember, at that times when you were building a token stream, it looked like that. So you had something like a method where you can pass in the token, which was something containing everything about a token, like the term text, the positions, and everything. And this method was just like an iterator returning a new token of it. So, and then a little bit later, to not create so many token objects, we added something like a reusable token. But in Lucene 2.9, we already introduced the new API, which was using the attribute sources, where you can add attributes to your token stream and then fill in those attributes. And the very, very funny thing is that was Michael Busch and I at that time. We were thinking about how to make those APIs compatible to each other. And actually, there was something like 4 weeks spent in time just to allow people who had some own token streams implemented for Solar using the old API to still work with the token streams in the new API, which were using those attributes. So basically, in fact, all those the token class was retrofitted to also support attributes and all that stuff. So that was something which also led to a huge flood of commit emails. And with 3.0, this was all removed. So, and the next heavy committing step was then Lucene 4, where the development started in 2010. And the flexible indexing branch was the main stuff where heavy committing was done. The release, I looked it up, was in December 2012. I thought it was in 2011, but it's actually, it was in 2012 when Lucene 4 came out, which had a completely different API. And that was the first step where Lucene finally decided to get rid of backwards compatibility. We also got rid of, there was long discussions about that because a lot of people were complaining. But in fact, when we wanted to change and do something new in Lucene, we had to somehow get rid of the old stuff and not keep the backwards compatibility for forever. So the new architecture was then that we used the flexible indexing APIs and codecs that were able to customize the index file format. So you were able to replace, for example, the implementation that writes a posting list to your index, so you could test out new compression algorithms. And the index file format also had an information about what codec was used. So when you were loading an old index, the codec was looked up in the class path, so you can decode that stuff. The biggest change was the four-dimensional enumeration API. So the first thing was we split the terms from the fields, and then we had the docs enumeration and the positions enumeration, and that's how the API still looks like. And one funny detail at that time was the so-called surrogate stance. Is Mike McCandless here? He is sitting outside, yeah. It's this is something, because there was one change, and this was really, really interesting, because in Lucene 4, we still had to support old indexes. So that means you need to be able to read that old index, search on it, execute different types of queries. But the problem was, in the older versions of Lucene, we were still using UTF-16 characters. So that means we were using the string objects of Java as a character array and were writing them to disk as somehow 16-bit sequences. But with Lucene 4, we changed everything to use UTF-8 internally. The problem is, this works perfectly well, but as you know here, the posting list is an ordered list of terms. We got quickly into the trouble that the sort order of UTF-16 and UTF-8 is not identical. Okay, it's identical for most stuff like ASCII characters and Latin 1 characters and also Far East characters, but it gets broken once you got to the surrogates. So actually, in Lucene, we had to implement something which was on the fly while reading an old index and going through the turn enumeration. For example, when you were executing a phrase, range query or wildcard query, it has to that rely on the order of those terms. It has to on the fly somehow reorder the terms returned by the enumeration, and that was called the surrogate stance. So Mike McCandless spent a lot of time in discussions on the mailing list about that, how to reorder terms while iterating over them in alphabetical order. That was something. So we had a lot of tests. So we were creating old indexes with the older version of Lucene. Then we had a codec for reading that, and finally, in Lucene 5, we were able to throw that away, of course, because that was another thing that we changed at that time, was the backwards compatibility. We were deciding to only allow indexes to be read from the previous version, but not across borders. So you were not able to read an index in Lucene 4 that was created with Lucene 2. I think that still worked somehow, but it was not officially supported. And with the later versions, with Lucene 5, it was impossible to open a Lucene 3 index. Though you had to somehow run something which is an index upgrader, which of course did the surrogate stance to merge the segments into the new one in the correct sort order of those terms. Of course, most people won't see anything like that, but some people, I think it was the use case example of Mike McCandless was, I think, the Mormon characters which are outside the basic lingual plane, and he had something like indexing text with that one. I think it's only one or two books written in that script. And he was trying out that the sort order was correct after that. Another thing that was changed in Lucene 4 was something which is still not yet fully done, because Sola still has a field cache somewhere. It was moved several times, so because people were complaining, I cannot enable those stock values for my old indexes. So the field cache at that time, so that was another phrase which was coming in almost every talk, die field cache, die, also on the mailing list all the time. And actually, the idea here was previously when you wanted to sort on something on the index, you had to uninvert the index because you had the sorted sorted list of terms, but you wanted to get something where you could look up the value by having the document ID. So you just had to uninvert the whole index, so you have to look into the posting, so you have to go through all the terms, look up the posting list, and put that into a big array. And the idea here was simply with the doc values, why not store that array on disk? That's basically the idea behind the doc values, and then you can sort directly on that one. So that's the difference. So the row store is what the stored fields are, and the column store is what you're using for sorting, faceting, and all that stuff. So, okay, the next era in Lucene. So some of those here are going a little bit in parallel. So this one was also starting, I think, in 2011, which is a finite state era. So it was Robert Mir suddenly coming with an idea to implement regular expression queries using Lucene, and then he brought up the finite state thing. But actually, that's something which I invented originally when I came to Lucene, were the tree range queries. So actually, the idea was to somehow have in the index something like a state machine, and when you're executing the query, you're figuring out the best ways, which terms you want to search to make the range query as fast as possible, because the problem is in previous versions of Lucene, you had to go through all those terms in the range query, collect all the documents you found, and that took a lot of time if you were searching for a numeric range starting over half of the index. So it took very, very long time, and the idea here was to add some additional extra terms in your index, and that was then called numeric range query, but in Sola, it's up to date, it's still the tree range query, so it's still there. But this was also something like a first step where we were looking in the multi-term queries. And the other multi-term queries, so that are all queries going through several terms in the term dictionary, and all those queries here somehow rely on the order of those terms. So without the surrogate stance, all those queries wouldn't have worked with an old index in Lucene 4. So actually, you have your regular expressions. Previously, if you had a regular expression that started with something like the first one, HTTP or FTP, because there's no common prefix, it would have need to go through the whole term dictionary from the beginning to the end. And the idea of Robert Mir at that time was, if you understand the state machine behind the regular expression, you could also seek inside your term dictionary to the correct terms. So in that case, for the regular expression here, you only have to look at terms which start with HTTP and FTP. So actually, you can do that with two jumps, and the whole thing is done. And based on that, we started to implement, we imported a regular expression engine, and we re-implemented the regular expressions, wildcards, and later also fuzzy queries, with a new class, which is automata query. And this improved, especially for the fuzzy queries, I think by 400 times was one of the slides I've seen by Robert. And that was good. But in Lucene 4, we brought something else. So this came already a little bit earlier than Lucene 4, but it was not committed. The idea then was, if we can jump to the correct terms, the better idea would be to somehow just intersect those automaton queries. So the automaton query traverses the term dictionary, which was proposed to also be a state machine in parallel. And that was the change when those finite state automatons on the query side and transducers on the query side, so the term index was itself also built as a big state machine, so you were easily you could easily and very fast go through all those states and figure out which terms you have to match. There's also something like a funny picture here that was, I think, the talk of Robert Mir here on the right, but there's something important missing on that one. the beer at that time, I think it was in 2011, I was not sure, but he was the only committer who was served a beer inside his talk. And he was talking about the FST implementation in Lausanne, and that's something where he always brought something. There's a Twitter handle which is called Uwe Says, which is not owned by me. There are some people, I know Robert Mir was one of those who had access, and I think the other one is Mark Miller, and they had access to that. And whenever I was posting something on the mailing list, like for example the heavy committing stuff at the beginning, they were putting that into that Twitter Uwe Says account, and this was, I looked at the code, it was understandable why this thing was generified. I think I was complaining about Mike McCandles was adding generics to the FST implementation, which was already unreadable because it looks like C code. It still looks like C code, and adding something like generics was not good, and so that's some of the comments that I brought here. Yeah. Now, the heavy committing and the finite state stuff is gone. There's another thing that was very funny in the last 10 years, which is the hotspot era. So, do you remember 2011? It was, I think, the second Berlin buzzwords. And at that time, there was something in July 29, so it was after the Berlin Buzzwords Conference, when there was something going through the press, which was Java 7 parallelizes Lucene and Solar. Then suddenly there was something Java 7 could cause bugs in some Apache projects. That was the second one. Then Oracle releases buggy Java 7. That was coming afterwards. So it was clear that it's buggy. Then Apache and Oracle, both of them, warned about serious Java 7 compiler bugs. And finally, there was this funny, at that time it still was Lucid Imagination. I'm not sure if this blog post is still available. I haven't looked it up, so I was using the old screenshot I had. So Hossmann, he's one of the Solar committers, he just posted a blog post about don't use Java 7 for anything. Yeah, the background of that was that Oracle had no testing of Java 7, at least no public testing, so the Lucene team did not get any preview builds, and we were not able to check everything with Lucene. I think at that time we were already on 1.6, but I'm not 100% sure. So we did not yet use Java 7, of course, but we were not able to test everything. And the most funny thing was when you were opening Eclipse at that time and using Java 7, the first general availability version, and then opening the help in Eclipse, it was crashing because Eclipse is using Lucene for the search in the help. And this was unfortunately using the Porter stemmer, which crashed immediately after opening the help. So that was something which came here. So, but the reaction on that was quite nice because that started a close cooperation ship, and it also, I think, it led to the openness that we have now with OpenJDK and Oracle. Rory O'Donnell contacted us. There was a second incident a little bit later, and then we got weekly preview builds, and also other open source projects started to test with preview builds of Java 8 at that time, and later we also started to use Java 9, and this also finally led to the fact that we got easy and fast debugging, fast bug reporting. But actually, to show you the time frame, if you want to get a patch inside in Lucene, it can sometimes take half a year or a year. But if it's important, it can take 2 hours or 2 days, and then it's inside if it's serious. But actually, to figure out how to submit a bug report without going through the official Sun bug tracker was really horrible. And so it took us from 2011 up to up to last year, I think December, when I was invited to be an OpenJDK committer just for the purpose to have access to the OpenJDK bug tracker. So if you have any bug on where Apache Lucene is breaking because of some hotspot or whatever bug, then I'm the person who can immediately open a bug report and also comment and watch those issues. So that's something that's working. So that was really nice. And with Java 8, there were no large incidents anymore. Lucene already reported 5 serious bugs. But also, as you see here, Apache Maven, Groovy, and Scala, they were all on the list of most frequent bug reporters of serious bugs. So that was really something where Lucene, I think, helped also the Java ecosystem to improve. So another thing that is really related to that, which is also something like a personal hobby of myself, and also Robert Mir was always trying to do something like that. That's something, there's a blog post about it, which is still one of the most cited blog posts when it goes to Lucene, Zola, and Elasticsearch tuning. It's everywhere, it's somehow cited, which is about the memory mapping of the index. So in short, I don't want to go to the details here. The idea is to have the whole index, like a swap file, memory mapped into your virtual address space, so you can, especially if you want to do something like sorting on the doc values fields, you need random access and you don't want to do something like load something from disk if it's not already in some internal cache or something like that. So you just want to have the whole index like a big array in your operating system, and that's done by the memory mapping. And unfortunately, there's still a bug open, and we hope to get it fixed soon, is that the so-called, it's open since 1.4, the reporter is already inactive, but it's going to be fixed, and that's the famous add an unmap method to the map byte buffer. So when you memory map something, the UVSS here on top is something from the mailing list again. So the problem is that the pointer pointing to that huge area of memory on disk or the virtual address space is something like a 30 bytes big byte buffer object. And of course, this byte buffer object, if it's staying for a longer time in your JVM, it's never ever garbage collected. And the problem is, because of security reasons in the JVM, because you can crash the JVM, the memory allocated on disk and also in the virtual memory is only freed when this small 30 bytes object is garbage collected, which never ever happens in a Zola or Elasticsearch server unless you do a full garbage collection at some point, because it's just so small, though the garbage collector does not take any interest on that to remove it. So that was a problem. And because of that, we had several iterations with Oracle to fix that. It's still not fixed, but the hard thing was to just tell the JVM to unmap that byte buffers on disk, so you free the memory. But the only thing is you have to take care that you should not access it, because if you do it, it produces a segmentation fault, and then Zola or Elasticsearch is crashing. And because of Java 9 coming, the problem to the internal APIs in the JDK was completely shielded, so you were not able to do any reflection on internal classes in the JDK anymore. And so Lucene was the reason why we were the only one. So actually, Oracle wants to get rid of SunMisc Unsafe, but in Java 9, we were the project which made it possible to add a new method in SunMisc Unsafe, which was invoke cleaner, which is actually doing that. So you get a byte buffer and it unmaps it somewhere using a native system call behind that. So, but actually, it's now in a better placed way. So it's in SunMisc Unsafe, which is, as the name says, already unsafe, and you have the security restrictions to access it, so that's much better than deep diving into the internals of the JVM. So that's something which is also something that came to Lucene, and I know that a lot of other projects are now also using that. It was also funny, I was in a talk where somebody was discussing about that, and he also made some jokes, and I was like, that was ourselves. We did it because he was complaining, why was Oracle doing something like that? And that was, I think it was Heinz Kaputz in his talk who was making some jokes, and I was sitting there. Yeah, the next one is the policeman era, which is the final one also today. As a good policeman, I have all open source guns for code checking available. That was also some statement. I have no idea when I was bringing that. I think Robert Mir was winning that. So another thing is, which spent, I think, up to today, 4 or 5 years, was randomized testing. So Lucene was the first project which really used the randomized engine. That was in 2016, which was already far behind when we first implemented it. I think it was in 2012-13. When did we do that? He had a talk that was David Weiss, who was talking about randomizing tests, and it will blow your socks off. So basically, we use randomization everywhere during the tests. We are exchanging everything. Sometimes we use random data. And if something happens, something wrong happens, you can repeat it by just using the same seed. And because we have a lot of randomizations, we were running the Jenkins builds all the time. And of course, it found even more bugs in the JDK and Hotspot compiler. So we were always opening bugs on the OpenJDK bug tracker. So the randomized runners goals were compatibility. So it's just JUnit. You can still use it in your own project. It has a built-in randomization. The tests are somehow spawned in several JVMs. So you can make sure that they are running in parallel and don't see each other. And there are some utility methods. So that was the most funny thing. And a second thing is, which was also invented by Lucene, was if anybody knows of that. So for example, here is something like to lowercase, which leads to that funny article, a cell phone's missing dot kills 2 people, puts 3 more in jail. the reason for that is, if you are lowercasing hi-ho in Turkey, and you don't specify a locale for the lowercasing, it won't give you hi-ho, two uppercase in that case. No lowercase. Yeah, it works. Sorry, the code is a little bit strange. So actually, the capital I in Turkey is a capital I with a dot on top of that. And because Lucene is a really international application, we had all those issues, of course, if people are using that. The other stuff is calendars, input streams. And then we implemented in 2012 the tool for that, which is a forbidden API checker, which prevents anybody in Lucene to commit code, which is using something like system defaults, char sets, or even printing to system out or system R, or creating threads without a name or something like that. So it's already used by other projects like Elasticsearch. There's an Ant plugin, Maven Mojo, Gradle plugin, and it's available here. So you can still use it, and I encourage everybody to do that if you want to do static code analysis on that. The other one is the Policeman Jenkins, where we were trying to figure out all those bugs in the JDK. That was also some funny statement. that came when we had something where it was crashing again. So yeah, there was macOS crashing. So we are running Lucene with a lot of different configurations. That's the one from the weekend. JDK 13 is already running, 11, 12, also with fast debug. So, and you see if something happens, it looks like that, and then we start digging. And the last one now, so I have 5 more minutes. I think that should fit. is the Reiya era. So actually, this is a new calendar in Japan. And unfortunately, we had to change our Japanese tokenizer to identify that new term, because this is not in any dictionary. So actually, the tokenization was working wrong, though we had to patch the dictionary. And this is, I think, went into Lucene 8 or 8.1. So actually, you can now also index that stuff. But the main thing in Lucene 8, I don't want to go here into details, is that Lucene is now able to speed up some queries by factors of 40, 50. If you don't need the full count, the total document count of your results. So for example, if you have indexed all your stop words together and you're doing a big OR query, those queries can take a long time. And what we did here in the latest version now, in the latest, is to support that. The support in Zola is still missing or not yet complete. I think the issue is still open. Elasticsearch already have it, so you can execute a query. If you don't need any facets or aggregations, it would tell you, not 350,500 documents. It would simply say, there are more than 10,000 documents available. If your result set is smaller than that, it will give you the exact count. How does it work? We are storing something which is called impacts into the posting list, like the maximum TF and norm, and we do that also on multi levels in the skip list. And finally, that was the paper that inspired the whole thing. And So basically, that's coming. But I think to get more information about that one, you should visit the talk of Simon Willnauer tomorrow. Is there any other talk about that? I don't think. Not this year, yeah. So unfortunately, I had thought about if I should have a talk about that, but I was expecting Adrian to come, but he didn't come. So, okay. Yeah, that was the last slide, and that was something like so few. So do you have any questions? I think maybe it's only comments, so.
Right, let's think over.
Okay, I have a question. you said, don't use check style, it's totally broken. So what's wrong with check style? Everyone uses check style, right? So why?
This one, I don't really remember about that one. I think it was for the purpose of finding those static method calls, we were investigating to use PMD or check style to do the forbidden API stuff, and we figured out it wasn't working like that. And then, as of course, those comments were always somehow out of the context of the whole email. So okay, in that case, yeah, no, check style and PMD is, of course, perfectly fine, but I think you can look it up in the mailing list. As Isabel was talking this morning, everything is archived forever, so maybe you find that sentence in the context. Yeah.
All right, any more questions? I got a meta question, Uwe, looking back at now 10 years of Lucene development.
Yeah.
Are there any development, release, decision, regrets, things where you'd say, we'd do that differently today? For example, offering, I don't know, when to migrate between Java versions, be on the safe side or user-friendly side of giving out multiple releases that are backed by different Java versions, or be more radical and just move on?
Yeah. So I think, as I said, nowadays we already had some changes, like getting away from the strict backwards compatibility. But for example, there was one change. So I think with Lucene 8, you cannot read an index, even if you have updated it. That was created with Lucene 6. And that was a restriction because of some offsets going backwards and something like that. And there's currently, for example, a decision to maybe revise that. So that's something. But on the other hand, we should, in my opinion, change more often to later Java versions. So I think the last time will be with the Java 8, because Java 8 is very, very long term. And it's still something that everybody's using it, so we would keep it with Java 8. But the master version is already on Java 11, which is also long term. But in the future, I think we will upgrade more often, because even though Java 11 is long term, you only get long term if you pay for it, or if you're using a distribution of your Linux that supports a long term support. So basically, the people will need to update all the time, and I think Elasticsearch is shipping with OpenJDK 12 when you download it. By default, you must know it. Yeah, I think. So actually on the latest version, so what we need to do is, which makes it harder for us, we have to test it all the time with later versions, and sometimes have bug fix releases. Okay.
Thanks, Uwe. Let's thank the speaker again. And,